especially.
Yeah, so some new faces, some we saw already on last Tuesday. Last Tuesday we had already a session on the student engagement, online engagement, and that was quite an interesting session with
war there and military onslaught against Palestinians goes on unabated.
So yeah, thanks. And yeah, that was very interesting. And today we want to have a look more into that was more about learning design practices. We had two contributions there, and today we want to look closer into immersive technologies. And we have two interesting contributions here. First from Ángeles from UNED, and she's also UNESCO chair in distance education. And the second speaker will be Tom Gorman. He's a theater director and senior lecturer at Coventry University. And we'd like to start with Ángeles, who's going to talk about moving towards enriched immersive learning scenarios, the UNED 360 channel there. So Ángeles, the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me to this session of some topic that I really love, and I'm chair of the student support field of expertise in the empower. So engagement is maybe at the just the core of what we have to do with the students to keep them moving and to prevent dropout and so on. So I would like to share with you some experience we are developing. Still, it's ongoing. Moving toward this enriched immersive learning scenarios, but with a technology that we try not to be very expensive, because that would be a problem for us. So, well, right, I think that now we are all involved in this fever of immersive experience everywhere. So if you check in on the capitals in every part of the world, you're going to find out this scenarios in which you have immersive experiences. Here you have just an example of 12 best immersive experiences around the world, and you can find this Christmas, for instance, to have this feeling of being completely involved in an environment that is not your usual environment. So I like this sentence I saw in one webpage that they stated, it was in London, whether you want to step into a magical church, step into a painting, transport yourself to a whole other planet. I mean, there is something for you. So it's this need to go in immersive experiences that we can have now easily, but they are like this because they are immersive technologies, and immersive technologies, of course, have a long trajectory behind. I mean, it's not nothing new, but I think they are improving each time. And these technologies is what they lead is to generate this engagement and create this environment in which you are involved, and that are related to extended reality in terms of virtual reality that implies to be just in a space in which you normally need a headset or equipment to get this feeling of being involved. Augmented reality, in which with your mobile phones, for instance, you can have add-ons information and multimedia information on your mobile phones about things that have been integrated into the view you are having in your mobile, or mixed reality, in which, for instance, you can have your glasses and you are going to have this mix. You're watching the reality, but also a layer of virtual reality. So all of this is combined with technologies. But the truth is that investments are in those things that are related to business. I mean, that make money. And one of them is, of course, immersive videos for gaming, for gamification. And in these cases, you are going to find a lot of offer and continuous improvement. But what it is true is that they require, as you can see here, a high level of programming skills. I mean, a very specific technical stuff, and also financial because resources, because this is a really expensive market. So when we start thinking about other, in our case, in our university, other ways of developing immersive scenarios that wouldn't be so expensive, we came with this idea of 360 immersive videos or images that, although you can have, of course, the expensive ones with the headsets and so on, but they can you can have another other types of 360 images and videos that might be useful too and not so much expensive. So I would say that you can prepare, and although you haven't also, I have put all the links on the chat if you want to essay and try what I say. But if you have your mobile phone also and a QR application, maybe you can just try in the things I'm going to show you. So, well, very recently in October, we had the last EADTO conference in a wonderful city in Istanbul, and in this university, University of Istanbul, and organized by the Anadolu University. And at that time, of course, we all of us went to give a tour around the wonderful city and the wonderful places. One of them is the Hagia Sophia. And well, this is just a picture of mine. I mean, I love to take photographs, and so this is a picture I took. But if you go through the website and you check for 360 experiences of Hagia Sophia, for instance, this one, but there are others, I think that you will feel the difference. Although this is not something totally immersive in the sense of the headset and so on, but you could also use headset with this, for instance, this video, you will feel that the difference is that you can enjoy a picture for sure. But if you want to approach this experience of being in the place, on having the feeling of how it looks like, the size it has, how it sounds, all this, 360 degrees videos or images can give you this feeling. So what is a 360 video? Well, you may, all of you know what it is. It's a spherical and omnidirectional vision. So you can see everything that the camera has recorded, everything. But the interesting thing is you can interact and you can look at the places you want. You can look up, you can look down, right? I mean, you can be autonomous in this sense and just check what you are looking to. Of course, they can bring you this perception of being immersed. They need a technical equipment, of course, but it's not as expensive of others as I told you that you need a technical team, and you know that it can be difficult for universities to develop this kind of very sophisticated immersive videos. But 360, you need a specialized camera, and you have a wide range of cameras of different prices. Of course, you have the professional ones, but you can have some cameras just for 500 euros, for instance, or 600 euros, and ranging for between 4Ks or 8. And other things also, like a tripod, external microphones, or lighting equipment, remote control are interesting. But what you will need is a memory card with high capacity, because these videos take a lot of capacity. So fast memory cards will be required. Then you will need an editing software. I mean, cameras come with their own editing software, but normally it's a very basic one. So normally you will need an editing software to put on your laptop or desktop computer to work on the videos. But this is something that, again, is not so difficult to do in terms of a university department, for instance, or a research team. How do you watch the 360? Well, this is what is interesting, because maybe you just need your mobile phone, and so you can just check, or your computer, and you can just interact with the image or with the video. But also you can go forward and you can use Well, not very cheap equipment such as the Google card that you can even you can make it by yourself, or expensive, of course, headsets. But I mean, you see, there is a wide range of devices. 360 videos are very much used in showing in the market of selling houses. So now it's very common if you want to buy a house that you can go and with the 360 videos and just check around the house to have the impression. And also Google Image, for instance, Google Street View use that. This is the place where I live in Madrid, near the Retiro Park. And you just use these possibilities. You are going to just go around and you can, of course, have this impression of the place you want to look at, or if you are going to visit a city, or you want to find out how a street is, if you're going to stay there, things like that. So this is something we are very much used to do now. You can find, if you want, a lot of 360 videos just for like documentaries and so on, with offering immersive experiences about many things. But the thing here is, what about if we integrate this in education? Of course, this is not new. The new thing is in my university to use this. But of course, there are other universities that have developed and are doing research in that. So what about the application of this kind of videos in education? So we thought, we're sort of thinking about enriching our materials. We are a university that has a lot of work being done, and it's been doing constantly on multimedia materials, but for creating a student's immersive experience. Taking advantage of this, that is an easy way of developing these materials, and also lower prices. So in education, you will find, of course, the BBC and other videos just focused on education are on the internet. So we inspire in that, and we also start by looking for systematic evidence. I mean, systematic reviews, recent ones, there are many of them. Checking about if this is a good way of engaging students on promoting learning. So which is the current evidence we have about, I mean, coming from these experiences, research based on evidence? Well, of course, they increase the students' engagement and motivation, that's for sure. They can also increase the attention they are paying to, concentration, and in some sense, retention. Students say in a subjective way they feel a greater perception of learning. Also, something relevant, they increase positive affect and satisfaction, which is much more related to this side of emotions and positive emotions related to learning, the feeling of presence, and instead of being bored and just to not listen to or not reading what they have to do with the didactic materials. And something very interesting is they allow different perspectives or angles. So different, I'm psychologist, so individual differences matter. So to be able to have different perspectives, I mean, each student can have their own trajectory, their own way of looking at things. It's quite interesting. It's not just what the teachers say, look at that. No, you can check and look wherever you want. And in this sense, it's a way of personalization. Facilitate transfer of knowledge to other more real environments, such as in medicine, when they use that kind of videos. Or in terms of inclusion also, let students that cannot have access to some places for difficulties, personal difficulties, or just because in distance education, because things are in other places, not where you are, well, they let you know many interesting places, such as, for example, in history or in art, many different places where you can be and have this experience, more immersive experience. So other thing important is the recreated scenarios and situations in safe frameworks. That's, for instance, in pilots, when they are, I mean, since many years ago, they are trained with simulators and with this kind of immersive scenarios in a safe way. I mean, So yeah, that's some of the evidence regarding our 360 videos. So where are they used in education and the percentage? Well, they are used in any field, but what it is true is that they are the most used in medicine and healthcare, at least is the research we have and publications, and then in history and social sciences. What is true is there is not clear relationships with learning improvement in general. I mean, there are still things to clarify there if this is a better way of learning. But the thing is that they promote engagement. So in some way, they are going to produce a more satisfactory experience. So when we come to images and videos 360 for online learners, and this is an image created by DAL3, which is now a colleague working in presentation. So I asked for this idea. So when we came to the idea of online learners in our university, we started working in institutional under an institutional perspective with our UNED media department, with a long tradition in creating videos, radio, and so on. So they are very much interested in doing this kind of videos. We are the largest university in our country, a national one. So and a distance education university, and we think this can be a further step in our way of developing didactic materials. So we combine the Institute of Distance Education of my university, in which we are responsible for teaching innovation and teachers training and supporting students, and also the UNESCO Chair in Distance Education and the UNED Media Department, to apply to one project. And the general objective is to gather this evidence of 360 immersive videos and images for different reasons, different objectives. First, information and orientation purposes for our new students, for instance, to know our university, the buildings, the facilities, the laboratories, and so on. And secondly, for methodological purpose, to innovate in the kinds of learning activities that can be done with 360 videos in different fields. So we start disseminating this interest in our innovation conference in some 2 years ago, with some presentations about this topic. And we apply for an innovation project, an institutional one in our institution, to create this UNED 360 channel. We came with the idea of gathering the dinner teams, and also, I mean, in an institutional way, and also people from the academic staff, I mean, academic teams, to work in this project. We consult our Spanish antecedents in this with the work of Giuseppe Fregrapani in Universidad de Castilla-La Mancha. They had developed already 360 virtual tours with add-ons, with it's something that is really interesting. I mean, when you have these 360 videos or images and a virtual tour, you can add augmented reality, of course, and you can add to these images places where the student need to have more information with more videos, for instance, or an article, or a self-test assessment. So you can add, you can enrich also the 360 virtual tour. So the specific objective is to train, and we haven't done this in the past year, train our teaching and technical staff in the use of the equipment, and also to develop learning activities. We started trying to get them develop pilot experiences in orientation, information, and learning. And also, we need to develop now quality standards for these kind of videos, create the final UNED 360 channel in our UNED media in an open way also, and gather evidence of the use and satisfaction of the students. Our last goal would be to develop a 360 MOOC, with this kind of videos. So we created a UNED 360 online community to be working all the people that are linked to the project and to share things. And we bought the equipment, both a professional one and also one that the teachers can use in the edited the edition software. We did open webinars to those people, those academic teams that were interested. We did introductory workshops showing all the steps forward to create a 360 video or virtual tour. And we asked these academic teams to develop a storyboard, I mean, the storyboard with the learning activity they wanted to develop. There were also practical workshops by using the camera, because teachers need to use these cameras. These cameras are from the institution, so they have to take care of them. And well, some of the ongoing proposals they are developing are like this. They are proposals come from the mostly from the dean teams to show faculties and engineering schools, the buildings, facilities, the laboratories. They are very much interested in showing the students the laboratories, just to know them, but also for getting them accustomed to them before coming to a real practice. Also the Faculty of Psychology Laboratory. I mean, they are trying to build a student's confidence in knowing all the equipment before. Also knowing the library, the big on-site library we have in an academic team from the philology faculty are working and showing the students how to use the resources. Other learning activities, these learning activities that are really, I think they're very much interesting is that they are an academic team that are, they are developing videos, 360 videos, showing things to the child's level, for instance, the classroom and so on, at the child's level. So how children see things. Others are developing how the teachers, these are teams from the Faculty of Education, could develop school playgrounds as learning spaces, what should be a school playground, or how to use a child neuropsychological assessment material and the materials to show them to get the teachers accustomed and the evaluators accustomed to these kind of batteries. Finally, there are also practical activities that are going to be developed related to ergonomics and virtual psychosociology. So how work environments should be, analysis of DNI fragments with sophisticated equipment, and so they show students how to work with this equipment, radiation field of horns. They even took a camera inside one of these horns to see how it is inside. So, well, many creativity here to get students involved in the these learning activities. And now we have some pilots, just recordings. They don't have add-ons. They are not really just the final activities, but they have been done to just check how they work, these cameras. And so we have the UNED library and the director talking about the library, or the Faculty of Psychology that it's showed by the dean, or the specific laboratory we have in psychology. So these are kinds of pilots. We are in the second year, so now we are working in the development of the storyboards, and they are doing the recordings, and also the academy, the UNED media professional staff want to record the buildings really in a professional way with this kind of cameras. So now we're just coming to the end. If you think of AI, they are AI already. They are already tools to create 3D worlds. And one of the first things that the AI also can help us to maybe to create videos with AI and 360 videos is just to create, of course, with prompts for the AI. And the AI also it can help us to increase the engaging instructions to create a 360 environment made also by AI. So this is one example I did the other day, and I wanted to recreate a laboratory in a 360 a perspective created by an AI application, a website. And well, also ChatGPT gave me a more precise description of the things that they should appear there. Oh, of course, this is just to have an idea, because if you want to go to a real laboratory, you would need to take real pictures, at least at this moment. Maybe in the future, the AI would recreate exactly and precisely at the laboratory. But this is the image it created for me. So if you want to play us a little bit, I know we don't have so much time now, but maybe if you are interested then afterwards. Well, I found two websites in which you can create, just introduce your prompt, as you can see here, and it will recreate a 360 environment, just if you want to create things and you feel creative. So these are the two free spaces, websites where you can go there, and on the chat you have the links. So my proposal is you can go there, you can create your prompt, write down the prompt with this space you want to generate in 360, and I would suggest that in the first place take the right one, it's easier. And it will create an image, in a 360 image. But this image, you have to download it to your computer. Okay. So if you download it, I created a Padlet, and I start uploading to examples, just for playing a little bit with this kind of a scenario. So these are two I ask to the two different applications, and this is a collaborative Padlet. Of course, you can see that you have also the link on the chat. You can upload here the picture you created with one of the two web pages, or if you find another place and you want to upload the picture, that would be okay. But of course, if you upload the picture here, we will create like some examples, no? Or these scenarios you have created, or your imagination about that. The thing is, you cannot see on 360 just on the Padlet. So you have also to download the image, and then to use, this is also a free viewer of 360 images. So those that you create, you can upload them here, and we will be able then to watch your contribution if you want, if you feel creative and just want to test this, that of course that wouldn't be a real world practice, for instance, for students, but just to generate activities in creativity. It's fun, and it's a way of exploring also how AI is also starting to give us support. So that's it. Of course, this is another final, what I presented, the final work. And we are in ongoing work, as I said. So let's see in the next months what we came about. And I hope to be able to show the UNED channel, the 360 UNED channel of the university. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ángeles. I think people have a lot of fun with that exercise they can do. Are there any questions for Ángeles now at this moment? Also very good. Yeah, I was just, myself was wondering, I'm just translating that into practice. What faculties mainly are using this? You gave two examples there. Is that is it faculty bound, so to say, connected to a faculty? To use that, and at what point do they decide to use this system?
Well, what I did last year was to start talking to all the deans, the deaneries, I mean, the deans and the directors of the schools, if they wanted to join this project. And I think all of them, except I think philosophy, all of them did they wanted to start thinking about this and in the first place to develop those videos regarding the facilities of the of each faculty and the laboratories and so on. But most of them wanted that. But then came the second phase in which the academic staff was also invited to participate. Mm-hmm. And most of them belong to the engineering schools, because they want really to show students how the laboratories are, the equipments and so on, and also the Faculty of Education. So the Faculty of Education with all these learning activities related to, they have a new degree for educating children. It's a new degree, and they were very much interested in start developing this kind of videos, such as those that projects that they want to develop, those related to how a children see things that is, I mean, that you start recording, you know, going down and start recording like this. And it was, I thought it was that's a very good one, because I mean, to teach teachers how your students, your little ones are going to see things, you know, or the school and the things. So I think we can start getting some good examples also from psychology, because they want to test this, for instance, immersive scenarios for phobias, for instance, phobia to closed spaces and so on. So let's see within some months.
Yeah, really interesting. I think especially also in distance education to bring people to different perspectives, bring them in the real situation. And also like the introduction to the laboratory, when it takes otherwise many times to get acquainted with the laboratory. But if you can already do that by this, it's really, really helpful, I believe.
Amazing. And also we thought, well, let's see a university such as ours that we have students and tutors all over the country.
Yeah.
So if they send the local centers and so on, also buy cameras like that when they can also make recordings in the rural and in other cities spaces, and to have you know, more immersive scenarios about art and about culture, history and so on, because we are everywhere.
Yeah, no, really, that's really interesting. Thanks so much, Ángeles. Thanks for your presentation. Then we go to Tom, and there is a different perspective also on interactivity. They are really looking forward to that, Tom.
Okay, I'll just line things up. Let me just hit play on this mic, and then hopefully it's not going to work that way. Let me just go share screen. Sorry, there's always this moment in an online presentation.
Yeah, there it is.
So okay, hopefully you'll be able to hear and see some of the video stuff that I'm going to show you. Yeah, I'm Tom. I'm a lecturer at Coventry University. And in 2015, I embarked on this long-form project with the University of Tampere in Finland. This is just a timeline of what we've done so far and a little glimpse into the future. We started, obviously, we've done a lot of Shakespeare. That's kind of how it started. I'll explain the history of it. And this year, 2024, we're collaborating with Issa Dib in Palma, Mallorca, on Romeo and Juliet. So I like this quote that I always use from Clay Shirky to advocate that I'm not as someone who advocates technology as a better way of working. I'm advocating technology as a second best way of working, rather controversially, because ultimately to work practically in theatre, to kind of make work, the best way to do it is to get people together into a room. However, to work internationally, the way we want to work internationally is very expensive. It also has kind of climate impact. So we've kind of been doing this experiment in trying to rehearse and educate what we call immersive telepresence. I'll show a quick 2-minute clip which will help to contextualize things, I hope.
In the end, I was really surprised how immersive it could be to act out a scene just with this screen in as the connector.
But once you get used to it, it kind of felt that we were in the same room. All the distance got smaller and smaller.
It's made the world seem smaller, it's more accessible.
Yeah, I love it. I can't get enough of it.
I genuinely love this project. Yeah. I love how unique it is. So really, this was a great way to bring people from other countries together in the same room, really, and open up new possibilities for future projects. I feel like this is very beneficial for us thinking about the future. Now we have all these new people in our lives who live in another country.
It's a worthy tool, and it should never be thought of as a gimmick. It's a good tool.
And once we got the hold of it, it was really like a very magical experience, almost.
It was,
to have these
yeah.
people in the same room with you, and also it's another country, life-sized.
Mm. We all sort of came together as sort of like kids in a playground. Mm. Kids make friends without a worry, and we all sort of jumped at each other like and made friends.
So it was quite exciting, the whole experiment. So it really felt that we met personally, and during the virtual lessons that we were in the same room, and the distance got smaller and smaller. Yeah, I'm repeating myself.
So hopefully that gives you a little bit of context about what we've been doing. And I should emphasize, which I'll go through the history of this, but we didn't intend to do this. This was a Skype lecture that really got out of hand. And we've learned about it after doing it. So we've kind of gone the wrong way around, in that we've learned our trade after the first iteration. But the first iteration of it, we really went into it with a level of breathtaking ignorance now that we think back at it. And kind of researching the history of arts collaboration using networks took us back to 1897, believe it or not, with this gadget called the teleharmonium, which was an American gadget created by a guy called Thaddeus Cahill. Weighed 200 tons, and the idea was to have distributed music before the age of radio, distributed over the telephone lines. Now, unfortunately, it brought down the New York Stock Exchange, which is what sealed its fate. It had its own building in New York. People thought they were hearing ghosts on their phone lines, and it was eventually melted down. But it was a kind of noble experiment in trying to make music at a distance. The other kind of key moment as well was Hole in Space, which was what was known as a kind of video sculpture. Between a shopfront in New York and a shopfront in Los Angeles. And it used, of course, a satellite. It's called the mother of all video chats, or the world's first ever Skype call. And Kit Galloway and Sherry Rabinowitz, who kind of installed this, gave the public no context for what was happening. So I'll show you just a quick little clip of the public reacting to the very first ever video chat.
Who are we talking to? Are they actors? They look like young people in the show.
They're just people like you and me.
My God, it looks like Chorus Line having a little lunch break.
And now we're sitting on Zoom having this kind of international talk, but it's amazing kind of how mind-blowing that was. In terms of arts education, the first kind of movement was Pauline Oliveros and PictureTel, and it took me a lot of effort to find a picture of PictureTel. And the latency was 5 seconds, so the picture only refreshed every 5 seconds, which obviously limited what they could do. But the idea was to try and create music together. And I'm going to show you a few examples now of what is possible at the moment in terms of being able to work and perform and what technologies are out there. We use one type of technology. These are some other technologies that we don't use. So the big one in terms of music education is a thing called LOLA, low latency audio, which was developed in Trieste in Italy. And it's PC-based, so it uses a computer, but with very, very specialized parts. Can be a little bit buggy, quite difficult to use. But the example I'm now going to show you is a pianist in Tallinn, Estonia, and a cellist in Vienna playing together. And this is from 2022. So... And the other one is a Czech invention called UltraGrid or MVTP, which is free, but you need to be really good at coding to use it. And it was developed in the Czech Republic. You can get latency as low as 50 milliseconds using that, providing you have a good connection or a good network. And this is Tallinn and Prague using MVTP, again, at the same conference. So that's just to provide some context. One of the things I always get accused of is it's just Big Zoom. It's not Big Zoom. The question we had initially when we wanted to collaborate together and the Finns wanted to do some Shakespeare with us, we wanted to work in a foreign language, but we didn't really know what we were doing. So our first question was, how do we rehearse 1,125 miles apart? And this was our first ever test, flat screen TV in a place called the Disruptive Media Learning Lab, using Google Hangouts. And it really didn't work for us at all. And it's a problem that we discovered during the pandemic. Is it's not so much the technology, it's the size of our devices, which are the problems for us, in that your heads are absolutely tiny on the screen. For me, I'm using a MacBook and your heads are tiny. And as we also discovered when teaching in the pandemic, our domestic spaces are not particularly great for performing arts, or because many of the students I was teaching during the pandemic were in bedrooms. They get interrupted by pets, by parents making dinner, by dodgy connections that everyone has at home. So we went through all of these problems in 2015 thinking, what have we done? Why have we taken on this project? This is stupid. We couldn't get a room, so we built our own room, and we built our own room in a wind tunnel, which was used for testing aircraft engines because it was the only room we could get. And there we discovered all kinds of things about echo cancellation. It was an echoey space. We didn't know about latency. We didn't know about echo. And thankfully, we were in a wind tunnel. I think if we'd been in an acoustically really good space, we wouldn't have discovered all the problems that we've been able to diagnose for other partners in the future. So these are the kind of requirements you're going to need for this type of online collaboration. And each one of these will have a knock-on effect on something else. So something that's easy to use won't necessarily have the best audio-video quality or latency, but might be very accessible. Something that's not very accessible probably has very high quality audio and video, but can be quite difficult to access. And I'll show you an example of one of those towards the end. We also had to cope with latency, bandwidth, and jitter, which we're all very familiar with since the pandemic. But oddly, I still explain to management at university why certain things are just technically impossible, in that we will never be able to beat the speed of light. So no matter how good your network is, no matter how good your equipment is, the speed of light is a constant. So the further you are away, the more latency you're going to experience. And this is just the map from us to Finland in terms of the switches we go through. So, and oddly, the slowest part of this is leaving the campus and entering a campus. So the slowest parts of your journey when you work this way are getting out of your own campus and getting on to the other campus. The actual international journey is relatively quick. Everything also causes latency in the room. Your camera is causing latency. Your anything that's being converted from analog to digital is also causing latency. So one of the things we've learned over time is we use things like very low latency cameras. We use projectors with very high refresh rates, because even shaving 20 milliseconds off latency for what we do, it can make all the difference for the user experience. And it's actually something that's relatively easy to do if you kind of put the right equipment together. Last year, we collaborated with Miami, Florida International University, and this is just a test that we do at the start of every project. So this will give you an example of kind of how we start a project and how we test latency. So,
2, 3, clap.
What are the
No, let's go the other way.
You do it.
Ready? 1, 2, 3, clap.
So someone will always be in sync. So to us, everything looked in sync. To them, they got that 1 second latency, which is fine considering we're traveling all the way to Florida and back. So 1 second latency is relatively easy to cope with. I wouldn't want to form a jazz band and attempt to play with 1 second latency, though, but acting a bit of Shakespeare is fine. This is what we use. This is entry level. Polycom, they're ubiquitous in meeting rooms. One of the great things post-pandemic has been is you can pick these up really cheap on eBay. In fact, in 2019, we purchased one, £16,000. A couple of months ago, I bought a brand new one on eBay for myself at €400, because Zoom has basically negated the use of the meeting room. We can all do this from home. The lovely thing about these machines is they work and they can be hacked by a clever network technician, and they're better than Zoom for these purposes. And they are basically, because I think Polycom are going bust, they are limited. There's better equipment out there, but they are incredibly easy to use. You know, most universities have one sitting disused somewhere that you can access. The way we arrange the space is we put the screen, so we use a rear projection screen, we put it flush to the floor, we mic up the room in a way that it's natural acoustics, so the students don't wear any equipment. So the further you are away from the microphone, the louder you have to speak to kind of mimic the dynamics of a shared room. And the camera's at waist level, because we discovered that gives the illusion of eye contact. So if the camera's at waist level, you get that kind of sense of you can make eye contact and you can point at things. Again, this was something we discovered through trial and error. And we discovered that we didn't have to adapt our teaching practice very much. We usually kind of do a 2-week course. We now kind of test the system against things that we don't think will work. So initially for the first 2 years, we picked things we thought would work at a distance. Now we pick things that we don't think will work. We worked with Poznan in Poland. We did Julius Caesar. We placed Caesar in Poznan, and we placed the people who stabbed Caesar in Coventry. We had no idea what the solution to that would be, but that was part of the play of working with the students to go, well, how do we solve those problems when we work in a space like this? We also use Zoom now, but back in the day, we always use Facebook, and that functions as our notice board. So it's like a 3-room system. And we initially used Adobe Connect for lectures, contextual stuff, but also to give the students a room to rehearse and learn lines. But of course, they're students, so they drank beer in that room. And we discovered this is very important. The breakout space where the students can get to know each other, where they're away from us, where we're not interfering, really changes the dynamic in the main space, because as they drink beer, and this is something we were wowed by this in 2016, little did we know that this would be our lives in 2020, 2021. We were wowed by the fact that the students had discovered a way to drink beer online without us and sent us this picture. So that's the kind of setup. We began to experiment with more kind of intimate scenes. So this is an example of kind of how we work in terms of rehearsal. And this was from our second year. when we were looking at King Lear, and we were looking at something much more intimate than our big scenes that we looked at before. And the students discovered something very interesting about working with cameras. So,
you must stay with me. Pray now, forget and forgive, for I am old and foolish.
Yeah.
Do you feel like touching her?
I don't mean that
in a sinister way.
It's not like we should be like that we can't.
It's just amusing that, you know, the eye contact is so difficult because I know, is there any possibility to get any eye contact?
Yeah, when you look into the camera, you're looking straight into her face. So when she looks at, see, if I look there, I'm looking at you.
Yeah.
And if you look there, you're looking at me. So, I mean, don't be afraid of, like, almost trying to touch the screen, you know?
Yeah.
And see what happens. Should we do this one more time, and then you'll swap over you guys? And we'll play as well? Yeah.
You know, because here it looks like you're huge.
Well, see, here, he's
crazy.
The camera's in your forehead.
It's good for the scene. I think it's good for the scene because, like, there's this big moment for Lear.
Yeah.
So it gives some, like, I feel myself really small right now.
So we now play a lot more with scale. I mean, one exercise we do as well, which is a fairly typical theatre exercise, which is we get them to walk around the space and there's no leader, and we get them all to decide as a group when to stop, when to fall to the ground, and when to get back up. And usually when you do this in a kind of conventional space, you talk about the energy in the room. But we never do this on the first day. We always do this a few days into the exercise to see if we have developed a kind of group dynamic between the two groups. And it's also a little interesting experiment because I think a lot of online stuff is very active and busy. It's kind of nice to have an online moment of silence as well. And so these are the kind of experiments we've been conducting in terms of how we use this technology to do what I'm kind of calling an ordinary thing in an unordinary space, or an unordinary thing in an ordinary space. And we've done yoga classes, we've done skiing lessons. At one point, we even had a burlesque class. I'll just give you a very quick example of the kind of conventional teaching we do. A lot of throwing of invisible objects, because it helps the students get used to the camera and the space, but also it helps them test what latency we have, like knowing how long it takes an invisible object to get from Coventry to, in which case this is Helsinki we're working with, so this is Helsinki. And this is a bit of yoga being taken by Tina from Tampere in Finland.
Raise the arms. And hinge forward from the hips when you're breathing out. Right hand on the left leg, bend the right knee, breathe in left.
The most ambitious thing we've ever done, and I'm not going to show this, but I will, it makes a point about how this technology has been used, was we did an experiment in Miami, between Miami and Finland, in doing live motion capture. And we used this gadget, which is kind of the Rolls Royce of how to do this type of work. It's called an Imbra Media Server. It's used by Netflix, Amazon Prime. It can output 10 4K streams at the same time. Very, very low latency, £80,000, and incredibly difficult to use. And you have to use specialized cameras and all for it, but it's beautiful. That's a little diagram of how it works for nerds. But one of the most interesting things about it is this is a network of it being used in education and art settings. And as you know, notice there, a lot of the Nordic regions are using this with very high-speed networks, and just one in the UK, which is us. And it's enabled people like the Riksteatern in Stockholm to tour full pieces of musicals while leaving the orchestra in Stockholm, and enabling the orchestra to play live, really high quality, you know, high quality sound live along with the performers with low latency. It's mainly been used for music education, and it's a fascinating organization. That's a quick little clip, but I'll skip over for time. One of the things I've discovered as well, because it's not always gone well for us, we've had a few failed experiments, is both sides need to know what they're making. And this is an example of, if anyone watched the sitcom Friends, when the character of Rachel is trying to make a trifle, but the pages have got stuck together and it's got mixed up with a shepherd's pie, which explains the layer of beef sauteed with peas and onions. And if both sides aren't on the same page, and this is something I've learned through bitter experience, and now I try and get out of the way when I'm talking to potential partners, is both sides need to be making the same thing, because it is joint teaching, it is joint education. It's not one-way delivery. Both, you know, whoever is working on both sides need to be working to the same book, and need to have some form of agreement or compromise. We were affected by COVID, but one of the nice things about using the Polycom is I tested positive. I didn't feel well, but I got in really early in the morning to switch on the system, took a COVID test, discovered that I'd tested positive, and wiped everything down and left instructions on Facebook for the students. So the students were actually able to switch on this very complicated system without me, with just some cryptic clues and some photographs. I'm going to finish with just two clips. This was not an entirely successful experiment, but it did bring us back to the idea of working in a foreign language, because we had, and again, pre-Brexit, we had a lot more international students in the UK. So we were able to use a multitude of languages in this, which is very interesting, which is something we're going to return to by working with Majorca. So a quick clip of this.
She enjoys her work. She enjoys her work.
Подобається їй праця.
She is young and fit and happy with her body.
Güçlü, mutlu ve vücuduyla aşırı derecede mutlu.
And what she got with her body is her decision.
Și ce face cu corpul ei este decizia ei.
Porno doesn't stop her from leading a normal life.
Porno onu normal bir hayat yaşamaktan mahrum bırakamaz.
She has a regular boyfriend.
Normal bir erkek arkadaşı var.
So, and the final clip, which is from this year's collaboration, we were very lucky, although he was meant to be here live, but filming went over, we got to work with Andy Serkis, who you might know from the Lord of the Rings films as Gollum, or from Star Wars as Emperor Snoke, or Planet of the Apes as various apes. And this is just a quick little clip of him working with our students. It was actually more difficult to set up his Zoom link than our entire system. Because it's microphones and speakers going. So it actually took forever to give him a good experience. We wished he'd been there live. But this is just a little clip of him directing two students and having a little experiment.
Should we do a semicircle while we do it?
So you can go anywhere where you're keeping that distance from each other, and then just keep the volume as low and as intimate, and just speaking as you can rather than projecting.
Okay. What are we doing it from when we open the eyes? Do you want to start from She is alive, behold her eyelids?
Yeah.
So Christina, if you back up a little bit, there you go, that's it. That feels about right. Okay.
She is alive. Behold her eyelids, cases to those heavenly jewels which Pericles
And take it right down, Christina. Just start again, but take it right.
So
down.
That just gives you a little example of one of the most bizarre evenings of my life, where a famous Hollywood film star was directing us via Zoom using multiple screens. That's our website. We've got lots of documentary material. We've got lots of kind of how-to stuff, and actually links to other people who do a very similar thing to us, sometimes in a very different way. I love working this way, especially, and I'll get slightly political before the end. The loss of Erasmus to the UK has been a major blow to this project. Like, I cannot emphasize how serious a blow it has been for us and this project in terms of finding partners. But also just the fact that we are attempting to keep this kind of international European education alive through the system is so important to me and my students, because they get to kind of not only work in different cultures and countries and discover the similarities and the differences, but also just to the kind of the friendship level that they make through this. And often the friendships that are developed through this are more interesting than the piece of work that we actually make. So often the real joy comes from watching their interactions many years later on Facebook when they're wishing each other a happy birthday and going off on holidays together. So that's the real kind of joy I get out of this. And that is me.
Thanks so much, Tom. That was really, really interesting and quite an advanced system of getting students fully engaged. Maybe not possible for all universities there. I don't know if someone has a question for Tom on this. It's not the daily.
Well, I would like just to congratulate them, because I think it's a fascinating experience. And I really remember when we were in the lockdown and you found those wonderful videos with people singing any part of the world all together. And this experience was really moving to me. And I remember in one summer course I had this first year to put one of these videos, because it was really this experience of being together anywhere. But my question was, I'm not quite sure, have you had the real experience of a theater performance being like that? I mean, everywhere, with two teams in different places, different theaters?
Yeah, I mean, we've done a mix of stuff. I mean, the preferred method is that we actually go to the place, so we rehearse for 2 weeks and then we go and we just do it live, which is lovely for the students and lovely for us. We went to Miami and performed live. We've gone to Finland to perform live. We went to Poland and performed live, but often it's just not possible. I mean, especially we went into lockdown the day before we were meant to go to Finland, when we were working and waiting for Godot. So we performed live. We usually make the audience face each other, because there's that lovely sense of an audience being able to see each other. So the students talk about it's like performing in the round. There's a Romanian group who do a lot of live theater work like this between Bucharest and Portugal, called Teleencounters. They work a very different way, because they actually rehearse together in the same space and then split off to their separate nationalities to perform. So they work very differently than us. But yeah, I think it's, I mean, we're more interested in the education and rehearsal aspect of it. The performance aspect of it is, to a certain extent, is us singing for our supper, to give management something to see and something to celebrate so that they allow us to do it again. But for us, it's more the education and training aspect that we're really, really interested in.
Again, thanks so much. We are out of time, I'm afraid. Yep. Let me thank you, Tom and Ángeles, for your presentations today. It was really interesting. And I want to thank also the audience for attending. Before we leave, I just want to bring to your attention in the chat that we offer via the European Digital Education Hub also free mentorships for anyone who is interested in any form or expertise and digital education. So please check that out and apply. Thanks so much again, and have a good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.